In this video, we are going to continue our study of the topology of sets in a metric space by defining the notion of the boundary of a set. So this is a word that you may have already wanted to say at a few points in previous videos to communicate this idea of kind of being like on the edge of a set versus in the interior, which is a notion that we've already defined. So what is this edge of a set? Well, here's our version of it in real analysis. So we're going to call it the boundary of the set. I'm going to use this, what looks like partial derivative symbol to mean boundary, but you could see this denoted as, say, BD of A, boundary of A. The boundary of A is defined as the intersection of two closed sets. And I actually really think this definition is good to work with. So the boundary of A is the closure of A intersect the closure of A complement. That's it. So if you can close off A, you can close off A complement. What do they have in common? That is the boundary of the set. Take a moment to come up with one or two properties of the boundary that you can deduce just from looking at this definition. The first observation to make is that A and A complement play symmetric roles in this definition. So the boundary of A is also going to be the boundary of A complement. Let's see, if I write boundary of A complement, it's a little danger there that it looks like the boundary of A complement. So let me do this. Yeah, that's fine. The other observation I want to make is that both of these sets are closed. We're computing their intersection. Even if it's empty, it's still going to be closed. So the intersection of closed sets is always closed. So this boundary is closed. So boundaries are closed sets. Let's look at a few examples. I have three that we can do pretty quickly here, and then we will look at four more on the next slide before we wrap up with a couple of alternative characterizations of boundary, which I actually don't prefer to the definition. So I actually just like working with the definition. In that spirit, let's apply the definition to each of these examples. Don't try to picture it immediately. Try to just rely on our actual definition of boundary. So what is the boundary of an entire metric space where M here is unspecified? It's going to be the closure of M. I'm just going to write M bar. That's another way of saying closure. M bar intersect the complement of M. That's going to be the empty set bar. So here, this means closure, closure of M. Take the intersection of that with the closure of the empty set. Both of these sets are always closed in any metric space. So really, this is like saying, what is the intersection of the metric space and the empty set that has to be empty? Okay, so the boundary of any metric space is empty. What about the boundary of the set of integers as a subset of the Euclidean real number line? The boundary of the integers is going to be the closure of the integers. Intersect the closure of the integers complement. This you might want to just picture. So if you imagine the integers and take the complement, it's a bunch of little open intervals kind of separated by the integers. Okay, integers are already closed as a set. It's a closed set. So if I took the complement, let me just sketch it over here. So integers, probably doing this more slowly than is needed, but just want to make sure I'm communicating precisely what's going on. Each of these is an accumulation point for the complement. So each integer is an accumulation point for the complement. We close it off means really just take the whole real number line. So integers are their own boundary. The set of boundary points for the integers is the integers. For the last one, what about rationals? Okay, we need to take rationals, close that off. Take irrationals, close that off. Both of those closures will be the whole real number line. So the boundary of the set of rationals is the real number line. And like we mentioned a moment ago, that means it's also the boundary for the set of irrational numbers. Okay, make sure you understand these and then we'll look at four more examples. All right, what I would like for you to do is pause and work out the boundaries of these four examples. So we have an interval on R, we have the Archimedean set on R, then we have the first and third quadrants as a subset of R2. And then I just have any kind of subset of a discrete metric space. Fully work these out because I'm actually not going to talk through them that much. I'm just going to put up the definition and the result. All right, for each of them, I'm going to give you the intersection. So the closure of this interval would be the closed interval from 0 to 1. Then we're going to take the intersection of that with the complement, sorry, the closure of the complement. So that's going to be from negative infinity to 0 inclusive and from 1 to infinity. What do they have in common? The singleton points at 0 and 1, which is probably what you would expect for an interval. But now we've worked through the details. For the Archimedean set, the closure, let me just call the set A. The closure is A together with its accumulation point at 0. Kind of like how the closure of the complement of integers was R, that's also happening here. So the boundary is going to be the original set together with the point at 0. For the third one, I'm going to sketch a picture. We have the kind of interior of the first and third quadrants. So when we close that off, it's like this. Sorry, I did that like first quadrant and also third quadrant. The intersection of that with the complement is actually, it's the axes together with the second and fourth quadrants. So that's the closure of the complement. What do they have in common? The axes. Okay, so that is the third example drawn in R2. And then for the last one, I'm not being too specific here because it's a general result for discrete metric spaces. Any subset of a discrete metric space is closed. So no matter what A is, and no matter what A complement is, they are both closed. So really, I need to take the intersection of the set A and its complement, which is empty. Okay, hopefully these 7 examples that we've done have now illustrated how to compute boundaries. I think the definition is great to work with. So sometimes in topology, you get a definition, like perhaps that of a closure is one where it doesn't feel like maybe the easiest thing to work with. So you get alternative characterizations and they're easier to work with. I'm now going to give you kind of 2 alternative characterizations. I don't think they're easier to work with, but you're probably going to these characterizations instinctively anyway. So let's go through them. For this first characterization of boundary, while I've written this very symbolically, what we're saying is something very natural. That's what I meant when I said your mind is probably already going to these characterizations. So this statement, it's if and only if. And what we're saying is that X is in the boundary of A if and only if basically every open neighborhood of X picks up something from A and something from A complement. Now that feels natural because it's like if you're on the boundary, you're kind of between the two sets. So it's like near you should be points from both sets. And that's really what this is making precise. We are going to prove this, and I'm going to prove it using a dichotomy. Whatever X is, it's either in A or it's not in A. So one or the other is true. That's going to lead us to do a proof by cases. We will do the first case, and then the second case is going to be a lot faster because of the symmetry between A and A complement in the definition of boundary and also in the statement. Okay, so for our first case, let's consider that X is in A. If it's in A, then it's in the closure of A. So I already know it's in one of the sets in that intersection in the definition of boundary. That means it's enough to say that X is in the boundary of A if and only if, for this kind of point, X is in the closure of A complement. It's not in A complement. So if it's in the closure of A complement, then it must be an accumulation point of A complement. I'm going to write AP for accumulation point. So X is an accumulation point of A complement. Then because X is not in A complement, we can now say this is true if and only if every neighborhood, every open neighborhood of X scoops up something from A complement. I'm actually going to phrase it in a way that mirrors the statement we're trying to prove. So this is true if and only if for all epsilon greater than 0, the epsilon neighborhood around X scoops up something from A complement. In other words, it has non-empty intersection with A complement. Okay, you might think I've only shown half of the statement, but maybe I should add up here. Then if X is in A, it's in all of the epsilon neighborhoods that we would draw around it. Okay, so let me add that up there. Kind of forgot that, but if X is already in the set, then any open neighborhood around X contains X, and that's good enough for this statement. Okay, so if X is in the set, then it's in every open neighborhood of it, which means that every open neighborhood of it has non-empty intersection with A. And then looking at the complement, we have this argument. Let's pause for a moment, digest this, make sure you agree that I've shown the result that we needed to show for the case that X is in the set A. And then I will come back and give you a sort of condensed version of this to handle the other case where X is not in A. For the second case, if X is in a complement, then again, X itself can be the point in the intersection of any neighborhood around it and a complement. So let me say then X is in any epsilon neighborhood's intersection with a complement. Okay, so that takes care of half of this requirement. And X is in the boundary of A if and only if. What I'm going to do here is acknowledge that, sorry, that should be more of a boundary symbol, that the boundary of A is the same thing as the boundary of A complement. So we have that symmetry. And now it's the same scenario that we described up here. So it's like we're looking at a complement now. So if I kind of mirror the statement, but complement everything, coming down here, we would say, you know, follow this thought process. You get to, for all epsilon greater than zero, the epsilon neighborhood around X intersect a complement complement. So A is non-empty. Okay, so that wraps up this alternative characterization of the boundary. Let's look at one more. Again, here is another statement that you may have immediately started to reach with your intuition, and that is that the boundary of a set is the closure of the set, take away the interior, kind of leaving you with what's on the edge. Let's prove this, and what I'm going to do is start by recognizing that if you take the closure of A and remove a set, that is equivalent to taking the closure of A and computing its intersection with the complement of this. Probably don't need the outermost parentheses there. And now this looks a lot like the actual definition of boundary. It's just a recharacterization of the second set in that definition. So it suffices, I'll get a different marker. It suffices to show that this is equivalent to the closure of a complement. So we need to show that the interior of A, the complement of that, is equal to the closure of a complement. It has a chance because both are closed. So interior of A is an open set, the complement is closed, this is closed. So maybe it's true, turns out it is. This is going to be set containment. So I want to show that a point in this set must also be in this set and vice versa. We can actually do both directions at the same time. So notice X is in the interior of A complement. If and only if X is not in the interior of A. I'm not going to write that because that's just another way of saying this. What does it mean to be in the interior? You're an interior point if there's a neighborhood around you that stays inside of A. So there are really two possibilities here for X. Either X is in A, but it's not an interior point, which means no neighborhood of X stays inside of A, or X is just not even in A. Okay, so it's really going to be like a two-line pairing over here. So version one, X is in A, and for all, that was supposed to be an and for all epsilon greater than zero, the epsilon neighborhood around X is not a subset of A, meaning it contains some points from A complement, Or X is just like not even an A, it's an A complement. Wouldn't even have a chance to be in the interior in that case. Think about this, see that you agree with them, and then see if you can finish the argument. I'll come back and do it. Okay, when I was writing this, I alluded to the next realization, which is that every neighborhood of X scoops up something from a complement. Since X is in A, that's enough to know that X is an accumulation point or limit point of a complement. So I'm going to kind of take line one and continue it here. X in A and X is an AP of a complement, or X is in a complement. Okay. So this first line is really a restatement of this, but now I'm saying either X is an accumulation point of a complement or X is in a complement. That's one way of saying X is in the closure of a complement. Backwards direction, if you read it bottom to top, it also works. So we're done. Okay, hope you enjoyed this look at the boundary of a set.